Hello and welcome to a brand new programme dedicated to showcasing everything great about rugby union in Yorkshire. We'll be bringing you the latest news and views from the county, tackling all the major issues and talking points within the game, visiting different clubs around the region and having some fun along the way too. This is what's coming up in show number one. Well, that's what's coming up in this show. If you would like to take part in a future episode, then we'd love to hear from you, whether that's promoting your events or your news, or you'd like your club to be one of our grassroots profile teams in the future, then please do get in contact via the details on the screen right now. But we start this show with Rotherham Titans. They've had a mixed season in the championship so far, so we popped along to Clifton Lane to find out how things are going for them, both on and off the field. Great to see you. Thanks a lot for having us down to Clifton Lane. Firstly, as we stand now, first month into 2017, how are you feeling about how the season's gone so far for the Titans?
Look, it's been pretty tough this year, to be honest with you. We've had a ridiculous list of injuries, but you know that's life and you've got to get on with it. Disappointed in our position in the table, and because it's so close in the table, those you know, London Scottish at home and Bedford away and the draw against Nottingham, you know, they're just so tight games, whereas if it had gone either way, you're in the top half of the table. But, you know, that's the league structure, isn't it?
You mentioned the big injuries this season. That's obviously been a big challenge for you. But what are your major challenges as a head coach at a club like Rotherham?
I think if you can look at it either way, can't you? You can look at it as a challenge or you can look at it as just an opportunity. And what I mean by an opportunity, you know, there's no hidden secrets within Rotherham. We can only cut the cloth accordingly. And I think that what that does in a place like this, youngsters who come here have to play. And I think that's the message that constantly comes out. And that was something when I came here, I thought, well, you know that you're not going to be in that scenario where you were with London Welsh or Cardiff Blues, whereas if you have those injuries, you can just go out and sometimes recruit a like for like. You know, and as we see in some of the other championship clubs, you know, they get an injury and all of a sudden a Super 15 player appears or an Australian international or, you know, a premiership player. Whereas where we're at, if we get injuries, you know, the lad from Alionians appears or the lad from Leeds Beckett or somebody who's haven't been playing any rugby in a championship team. So that's the big thing. And I see that as an opportunity. I don't see that as a challenge. I see it as you've got to work, haven't you? In an environment like this, you're rolling the sleeves up. You're all hands on deck, on and off the field.
You had great success at London Welsh, getting them promoted to the Premiership a couple of seasons ago. Do you see some similarities with Rotherham in terms of the style of the actual club?
Yeah, I do, actually. Yeah, that's a very valid point as we look out the window here, you know. We were based at Old Deer Park, you know, and, you know, you have that traditional clubhouse like we've got here at Clifton Lane and, you know, the field, no different. And I think what the massive similarities are is that whether it's on-field or off-field, there's a very good family environment. And, you know, just coming through the clubhouse there, you know, all the volunteers who come in, you know, on a daily basis to Clifton Lane to do all the work, you know, the wear and tear of the clubhouse. It's phenomenal, you know, and there's a massive similarity in my, you know, I'm from a small club in Wales called Llantyfarnwy, and it's no different. You know, you have to roll your sleeves up in these kind of clubs, which hopefully will be something that never gets lost.
You mentioned the volunteers, so many good ones here. one in particular, the club doctor of 25 years, Chris Mears, recently paid tribute to at the Rugby Writers Dinner for his service to Rotherham. How important are the contributions for people like Chris and the other volunteers at clubs like the Titans?
Oh, it's second to none, isn't it? You know, what you think of from the time I've sort of come to the club, you know, Chris, and we know the 25 years, but what strikes me with him is the fact that, you know, he can't do enough for you. It's unbelievable, actually, you know, and I think sometimes, you know, when you go, lads coming in, and you forget about those little sort of, you have to register with the GP and you've got to do things, but he does everything for the players. And what I mean by that, it's unbelievable. 25 years, that is, you know, that's an achievement within itself. And, you know, I see the VPs on a regular basis at the club, you know, whether it's, you know, fixing the seats in the stand or painting the club or doing something, they hear every day, you know. And that's a passion, isn't it? That's, you know, you can't make somebody do that. You've got to want to do that. They get up in that morning with the enthusiasm and say, right, I'm going to go down to Rotherham and I'm going to just, you know, do my little bit. And whether it's walking around picking up the rubbish, they're unbelievable, honestly. That's a massive eye-opener.
We mentioned kind of similarities with London Welsh, again, a team you got promoted with. What's the plan for Rotherham? Is Premiership a goal, short, medium term? Do bigger steps and concrete steps need to be put in place before that could maybe be a reality again?
I think that the word is ambition, and there's plenty of ambition within the club, but what you'll find with Rotherham, they can only live within their means, and they're very good at that. Whereas, you know what it's like, sometimes you can get quite carried away and try and live outside your means, and then unfortunately what we've seen with London Welsh, you know, that's come back to haunt them a little bit. So what you find with Martin and Nick, you know, they're very grounded gentlemen who absolutely die for the club, you know, but they're also realistic of how much they can, you know, how much they can put into the club as well. And you know, without those two gentlemen, would there be a Rotherham Titans? You know, that would be a question, because they are, you know, they're unbelievable what they do.
And what about the squad, particularly when they're all fit? Again, you've coached at the very highest level. What do you think about the talent of the lads you've got in this squad?
Oh, I wouldn't be surprised if two or three players this year, considering our position in the league, would go on to Premiership clubs. I would not be surprised. And it'd be quite interesting to see, isn't it, a team as lowly as we are at the moment then manages to push players into Premiership rugby. So there's something got to be, something we're doing right here, isn't it?
So that's Rotherham, but what about our other two Championship clubs? Yorkshire Carnegie are looking strong in second place and already close to securing a playoff place, but that hasn't stopped more coaching changes at the club. Head coach Brian Redpath will leave at the end of the season after 2.5 years at Headingley. He'll take up a job outside of rugby and will be replaced by the current attack coach James Lowes, who was head coach at Yorkshire back in 2013-14 season. The club also say they are looking to appoint an experienced director of rugby to help Lowes out. For Redpath, he says his decision to leave will not affect his determination to get the club promoted back to the Premiership.
It's just another chapter of my life and my career that is a challenge for me, so I'm going to have to change some of the things I do, but that's just life for me, and it's one that I'm looking forward to. You know, and Apex have given me an avenue to come into that mix and in their world, still within sport, hopefully. You know, for me, it's obviously it's important we try and finish the job that I was brought in to do. It'll be 2 years in March, is to get us into a position to be capable of promotion. And that last season was a bit hit and miss, and I think this season we've been far more consistent. And I would just love us to be really, you know, really strong and be real contenders come May time. And that will, you know, it'll be for their benefit as much as it is for me. It isn't a personal pride thing. It's for us all. I'm in it with Jimmy and Steve, Chris Gibson, Ian McGeeken, the board, everyone. I'm in it with them all. We've all got ambitions. We've all got desires. They haven't changed just because I'm moving on. Players, I'd love to see them get that, you know, the opportunity or avenue to play in the Premiership. You know, I'd love to be watching them when I get weekends off next year in the Premiership. I'd love to see some of these lads get exposed to that level and see where they can reach or what they need to improve on to reach that level.
Meanwhile, there's been more milestones set at Doncaster Knight, and by one man in particular. The club's strength and conditioning coach and winger, Dougie Flockhart, has recently played his 200th game for the Knights. Added to that, he's just become Doncaster's record point scorer, surpassing Rob Lyley's record as he passed the 1,030-point mark. Director of Rugby Clive Griffiths says Flockhart has been a major part of Doncaster's resurgence over the last three seasons.
To get 200 games at any club is a remarkable feat in the modern day, in the modern era. On the field, top player, one of the best goal kickers around, and of course, off the field with the strength and conditioning, he's got the boys to a really good place. And you know what I mentioned, one of the reasons why we were tough to beat is that because we've got that endurance in us that Dougie's implanted in the boys, and you know, they're able to see games out in that really important final quarter, final 10, final 5 minutes when a lot of things happen.
We're here at Yorkshire Carnegie's Kirkstall Training Ground in Leeds in order to put some of the squad up against each other in a challenge of dizzy conversion kicks. The challenge is as simple as it sounds. The players will place the ball in front of the post here on the 22 and have their normal run-up. But this is where it gets a little bit harder. They then must spin around quickly 10 times, then immediately start their run-up and strike the ball with the aim of knocking over a successful conversion kick over the crossbar. The winner will be the one that gets the most over. So let's see how the players get on. And fingers crossed we don't tear any hamstrings.
Chris Walker, I play back row.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, Pete Lucock centre.
My name's Richard Mayhew. I play back row for Yorkshire Carnegie. There we go. Hey, they're not doing Donny too, aren't they?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Three. Ten.
Al Davis, come off.
Let's go, Willie.
Chris Elder, fullback.
40. One more, right round.
Oh! That is genius.
Guy Bardell, lock. Let the boys play.
Richard Beck Jr.
Forty, come on. Come on, 40. There he is.
The goal kicker.
Oh,
I hope he's
Joe Ford, fly off. Yorkshire Carnegie.
Mackie.
Rugby
Union.
Yes, 40.
Send the kick, send the kick, send the kick. Oh,
is that a roll?
Oh.
That's how you do it now, it's your turn. Get in!
Well done to Pete Lewcock, the only Yorkshire Carnegie player to successfully knock over a dizzy kick. Now, normally I'd say to you, don't try this at home, leave it to the trained professionals. But as you can tell, they didn't do very well, did they? So have a go yourself, I'm sure you can do better. Now, every month we're going to feature a different grassroots club from around Yorkshire to find out what's going on with them, find out what they're doing well, share some good practice with you, and also find out about their challenges. We start with these guys, Yarnbury, a Yorkshire One club based in North Leeds in Horsforth. They this season have had particular success with playing numbers, highlighted by the fact on one particular Saturday this season they managed to field six senior sides. A great achievement, I'm sure you'd agree. So we headed along to their club to find out what their secret to success is.
It's a social club with a very big community spirit. Anybody who arrives at our club as a new player invariably takes the whole Yarnbury thing under its wing. You know, we're a very friendly club. People don't sit in a corner on their own when they first arrive. There's always somebody to talk to. And to be honest, most of the people up here have been here so long. They've come for the first time to play rugby, as yourself, you know, you meet so many friends. This is a great club for its community. It goes down to a lot to previous president Raymond Johnson, who, you know, was a stickler for the junior section. Bob Barber originally formed our junior section 50 years ago. And we pride ourselves on being a club that takes everybody.
One of Yarnbury's successes in recent years has been the amount of players involved in the senior setup. That's culminated in this season the club being able to field six senior sides on one Saturday. But how have they managed that?
Chris Ray. Chris is our rugby chairman and he's done a phenomenal job. Just badgering, texting, ringing constantly on people's tails, getting them to come up and play. Besides Chris, we have a phenomenal junior section and we've been really lucky over the last few years that a lot of our lads haven't gone to university. They've picked up apprenticeships and, you know, this apprenticeship scheme that a lot of people have decried, but to us and for rugby teams, I think it's been a great thing because, you know, these kids who often go away to uni and don't actually play rugby at uni because there's other things to do there, or they don't get in the uni teams because they're too high grade for them, they stay here and they carry on playing rugby with lads they've been playing rugby with since they were 7 years old, or since they've been 12, since they went to school together. And we've got a great transition through from juniors to seniors.
Getting out in the community as well, we've got a pretty good name and reputation in the local community, and I think we're seen as a club that looks after its players. People come here, they want to play rugby, they want to enjoy it. The emphasis isn't all just on winning, it's about, you know, the whole experience and enjoying it. So yeah, we build on that really.
That's going to generate quick ball.
Yarnbury fielding six senior sides shows just how strong adult rugby is in this part of the county. But it's not just about these blokes behind me, it's also about the junior section, the lifeblood of so many clubs up and down the county, and Yarnbury is no different.
And it's just flourished over the last few years. I think we've 200 plus juniors now, from under sevens up to Colts. We have teams in every age group. A lot of the parents are doing coaching courses, they do the refereeing courses. So at the end of the day, the kids are getting the best possible coaching, training. And the one thing I've always said about junior rugby is they learn respect. And if you learn respect as a kid, you take that through into, you know, as you get older.
We don't pay players. We are reliant on the junior section. And the great statistic was, you know, when we were down at Twickenham, out of the 23 players in that final, 16 had come through the junior section, and it's very similar. But we do also rely on institutions like TASC, Leeds Beckett, and, you know, people come to us and not many people leave us, you know, which is great, you know. So it is about professionalism with a small p. We like to challenge the players, try and stretch and challenge, but in the whole, it's about enjoyment. You know, they come along and they want to enjoy themselves. Winning is great. You know, on a Saturday, we want to win, but the whole club together, you know, it's about rugby, it's about the community.
Yarnbury, like a lot of grassroots clubs around the county, clearly have a lot of good things going for them. But what are the challenges?
The biggest challenge is finance, I feel. You know, the club is afloat. We do very well on our social side of things, and that keeps us money. We get sponsorship, like lots of clubs do. We run a lot of good things, good events. We have a beer festival in the summer, which does us exceptionally well. And that keeps us solvent. We hire the clubhouse out. Keeping people motivated is the other thing as well. You've got to have people who want to do jobs. And if you keep the club running well, people play with us, stay with us.
These boys clearly love playing for Yarnbury, but what is it about this North Leeds club that has attracted so many people over the last couple of years to play or sponsor or just volunteer?
One of the great things is we've broken down the barriers between first team rugby and the lower teams now, which, you know, when I played, it wasn't there. Everything was very much focused on just the first team. So we're fully inclusive in terms of, you know, the players we have all integrate together. They socialise together, they tour together, and we welcome every player, you know, regardless of ability, colour, creed, sexuality. You know, everyone's welcome. It's just, it's great to see.
We're a very friendly club. It's a good standard of rugby, a first team, and we've got second teams playing in merit tables, third team in a merit table, fourth, all playing to a higher level than they're actually graded at.
We'll look after the kids. We'll develop the kids. We'll give them all the things they need, the tools to get them through life, to make them good kids. You know, we'll teach them respect, we'll train them, keep them fit. You know, if not just for kids, but for adults. You come up here, you'll enjoy your rugby. You'll have a good time, you'll have a good laugh, a few beers, and that's the most important thing in life. Enjoy it.
Yep. Right, well done, well done, nice boys. Good work.
Now on the Yorkshire Rugby Union show, we focus on Doncaster Knights. They were Yorkshire's team of 2016. Last season, they finished second in the championship, reached the playoff final, and in that were a whisker away from beating Bristol and gaining promotion to the Premiership. This season, they hope to go one better and achieve that dream of top flight rugby. But what do we really know about them? We headed down to Castle Park to speak to Captain Michael Hills, who gave us an insight into the characters within the squad.
Hi there, I'm Michael Hills, captain of Doncaster Knights, and it's my job today to tell you a little bit about my team. Both our tens have got good skills, Simon and Deck, but just for all-round ability and skill level, I'm going to go Andy Bullamacow. Colin Quigley, easy one. Move on. Alex Shaw, by far. I don't think I've ever been to training and him not have something to moan about. And I often get texts throughout the week moaning about something. So yeah, Alex Shaw. Oh, most vain. Oh, I'd like to put myself up there, but I'm not going to. I'll have to go Sam Edgley again. He's currently just gone for the long hair surfer look, and he seems to be last out of the changing room every day, so I'll definitely go with him. We've got a few good characters in the team, to be honest. I'll go with Dougie Flockhart. He's quite a sly one. He gets his sly, funny ones in, but he always makes me laugh. Jack Ram just arrived from Tonga. He's put some big hits in the last few weeks, so I think that'll be an easy one for us. That
been a victim yet?
No, I haven't yet. Will Griff is a close second, and I've been a victim of that a couple of times in training, and that's not pleasant. Ben Hunter, for some reason, he always looks like he's dressed in the late 90s, school shoes and all that. Definitely him. Worst music taste. For me personally, Will Griff John, because all he seems to have on in the gym is like Slipknot or Korn, and it's just very, very heavy. Heavy, heavy rock stuff for me. Oh, easy one. I think it'd be easy for us all to say, but Matt Challoner. He's just a tough cookie, very hard trainer, hard man to, you know, good guy to know. I wouldn't want to meet him down a dark alley.
Colin Quigley, Doncaster Knights prop.
Hi, Joe Rees, tight end prop, and I play for Rotherham Titans.
Oh, I don't know. I know what films he's been in. I just can't mind his name. I've not got a clue, but I know what other films he's been in.
That's a good one to start. Benedict Cumberbatch. Yep, enjoy that.
I want to say Sydney, but I don't think it is. I think it's... is it Canberra?
The capital of Australia is Canberra.
Conor O'Shea.
Oh, I know this one. It's the old Harlequins coach, Conor O'Shea, I believe.
Is it French?
Oh, Stella. I'm going to guess Belgium.
It's not the guy with the top hat, is it? Is it Washington? George Washington?
Oh, was it Abraham Lincoln?
Is that the one that they tried to do over Simon Cowell with? Little Mix? I don't
know. I'll guess. One Direction. Guess.
I want to say Greg Little, but I don't. Sexton, I must have had.
Was it Owen Farrell?
Oh, I don't know. I'm terrible.
Oh, wow. not Bruce Willis. No idea.
Rovers Return?
One of them's the Wolfpack, I don't know if it's that one.
Richard Hill?
Oh, wow. Was it... Richard Cockerell?
Terrible.
Yes! Wales beat Scotland.
Thank you so much for watching the first episode of the Yorkshire Rugby Union Show. Really hope that you enjoyed it. If you have any ideas or feedback about what we can incorporate into future programmes, or you'd like your club to feature in a future show, then please do get in contact with us. Again, the details are on the screen right now. But for the time being, take care and goodbye.